studio today. We're at a very special location. And I'll give you a moment to guess because we have hard hats, we have special shoes, we have body count numbers on us. We're at the tunneling of the Mumbai Metro Rail Corporation, which is already very cool because we're going to go underground and check out how this is happening. But there's something else very cool about the Mumbai Metro Rail Corporation. It's headed by a woman. The managing director of the Mumbai Metro Rail Corporation is Ashwini Bhide. And you know how much I love women bosses. She's with us right now. Bhide, thank you so much for taking time out of your day and showing us around. And there's so much to talk about with the metro. There are controversies about trees, there are controversies about the car shed, but we're also very curious to show the people the work that's actually happening. So please. So what the audience must realize is that this particular line of tunneling that you can see behind me is special because the stretch of metro that we have operational right now in Mumbai, which is from Andheri to Ghatkopar, is above the ground. This will be completely underground. So it's new. The entire process of tunneling in this fashion is new for Mumbai, and that's why it's challenging. So I'm going to ask you very obvious questions that lay people will ask at this point, which is that we're so close to the sea. It rains so heavily in Mumbai, or when it rains, the roads fill up with water. So how will the tunnels not fill up with water when it rains in Mumbai? How are you going to keep it dry during the monsoon?
That is how the construction is done. So the construction methodology is used is in such a way that the tunnels are completely waterproof, or they are resistant to water. Because you see, this is the lining. So when the tunnels are drilled, at the same time, the machine lines the tunnel with these concrete segments.
Okay.
So this provides the necessary waterproofing or water resistance for this tunnel. And then behind this, there are rubber gaskets, which actually fixes, or even the smaller joints are fixed, and plus some grouts are used. So grouting is done. And that is why there is absolutely no gap between the rock outside and the and this casting.
So there's no place for the water to come in at all. It's like a pressure cooker.
As far as tunnel is concerned, it is completely waterproof. There is no space for the water to come inside. Wherever there are stations, then there would be some locations, for example entry exits or maybe some ventilation shafts which we have to keep. From there is a possibility of some water seepage. But when we plan the entry exits, they are done in such a way that their heights are above the high flood levels. And for that, we use last 100 years data. And we also have this 26 July, flood levels. So it goes, those entry exits are above that. So there is no way water can go inside. And whatever little bit of trickling of water would happen, that is properly channelized, and in the tunnel, entire tunnel, there would be sumps. So where the water, the channelized water is taken, and later on it is taken out.
So where we are standing right now, this is Mahim, and this is coming from Dharavi going to Siddhivinayak.
Yes.
How much of this is already done?
This particular TBM would make a drive of about 2.5 kilometers. So I think we have crossed even 1.5 kilometers of mark, gone much ahead of it. And by March next year, this machine would reach Dadar station.
Okay.
And then it will be taken out and the next drive will start.
And this will eventually reach Colaba. This is the line that goes to Colaba.
Yes, but the entire corridor is divided into 7 packages.
Okay.
So this particular package is from Siddhivinayak to Dharavi.
Yes.
But towards Colaba, there are 3 more packages.
Okay. So where work is happening simultaneously.
Yeah, work is happening simultaneously. So not that the same TBM would go up to Colaba.
Yes.
There would be all total 17 tunnel boring machines would be working for this project.
So tell me something, the deadline for this was December
2018,
which is this year.
We've
overshot a couple of deadlines. Do we have a fresh deadline on this right now?
For the project?
Yes.
The project deadline was never 2018. It was 2020.
Okay.
As per the original schedule. But because we already had some legal issues, our tree cutting was stayed by the court and we wasted almost 6 months time. So right now the deadline is rescheduled to 2021. So we will be commissioning first phase from our car depot at Aarey up to BKC in June 2021. and the entire corridor by December 2021.
So by December 2021, it will be possible to take a train from Dahisar till a metro from Dahisar to Colaba?
No, this corridor is from RA, that is Seeps to Colaba. But as you have rightly pointed out, Dahisar to Andheri, that corridor, elevated corridor, the work is happening. That is being executed by MMRDA. And there is a connection between that corridor as well as this corridor. So that would also get simultaneously completed and then it is for. But that is an elevated corridor. This is an underground.
This is an underground.
So people will have to have an interchange from that corridor at some location to this corridor.
What about stations? How many stations will you have on this corridor? And what is the level of completion on those stations?
This is a 33.5 kilometer long, fully underground corridor from Colaba to Seeps. And our car depot is at Aarey, maybe 500 meters ahead of Seeps. So we have 27 stations total for this particular corridor, and 26 stations are fully underground, and one station which is at Aarey, that is the car depot station, that is at ground, which would call the at grade station.
And so this, for example, will be filled up and the land will be given back to the collector. This is not the station.
If this is not the station, this is called launching shaft.
Okay.
So tunnel boring machines are lowered here and from here they start tunneling. We have almost 10 such shafts in this project. So this is for package 4, but each package has either one or two shafts. And for the entire corridor to do this tunneling, we need 17 tunnel boring machines.
What is the challenge of boring tunnels on Mumbai's topography?
Mumbai's topography, I mean, it may look like it's a city made of islands and there is some land is reclaimed. But at the same time, one must understand that at the base of it, there is hard rock. So it is basalt. So even if it is made of islands or there are some reclaimed parts, it doesn't matter. Because we are even going below Mithi River also. So at the riverbed, we have hard rock. So the challenge is actually the rock is very hard. So it takes more time for tunneling. But the positive side of it is very safe. Because doing tunneling in soil and doing tunneling in rock. So doing tunneling in rock is more predictive. It is more safe in terms of and for speed might get impacted, but in terms of your operational planning, this is much better. And Mumbai has this basalt rock. We also have some breccia and tuff. But most of these rock is grade 1 or good quality rock. In some cases, it is fractured rock, but TBM is very suitable for handling that kind of rock.
Well, I must ask you about the RA colony shed, because the NGT had stayed any sort of construction, any sort of dumping, any sort of tree cutting at RA. The Maharashtra government approached the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has disposed of that appeal as well. So how are you still constructing at RA?
There is no stay to any construction in RA. There is only stay that is also very recently given, which is for tree cutting, reclamation and dumping of debris. So neither are we dumping debris nor are we reclaiming any land. Only problem for us is tree cutting. So out of 25 hectares of land which we are going to use for car depot, 10 hectares is free of trees. So there is absolutely no ban from NGT to construct and our construction is going ahead. Now, where trees are concerned, we have already approached NGT and the hearing is scheduled on 14th of this month. So we are very sure once they hear our case.
How many trees will be lost in the colony?
For the entire project, if you see, because we need to cut trees even for stations, because most of our stations are below the road and on roadsides we have trees. So unless we cut trees, we can't go down. You can imagine what depth we have to start our work. So entire corridor, if you see, roughly 5,000 to 6,000 trees are getting impacted. Out of that, maybe 50% are for stations and alignment and remaining 50% are in depot. So we approach the tree authority for getting all clearances.
2,500 trees in the depot.
Roughly 2,500 to 3,000.
Is there no alternative for a location of the depot?
That issue has been completely dealt with. The whole alignment is according to that. So there is no question of reopening that issue. Lot of study before even finalizing the depot location. Different options were exercised and finally this option was finalized. when people raised that issue, state government again appointed another committee to look into the various options. However, no other feasible option came up. There was one option which was there at Kanjurmar, but that land is also till that it is not available. And plus, Kanjurmark is extending the corridor by another 10 kilometers, which is not feasible. And after going into all the pros and cons of various options, state government way back in December 2017 decided to go ahead with the same location. And there has never been any stay from NGT as has been projected, because NGT only had asked government to declare eco-sensitive zone around Sanjay Gandhi National Park. Which now central government has declared. However, Kardepo is outside that. Our land is not part of the eco-sensitive zone area.
Well, there have been a lot of people who are also talking about tree cutting in Colaba and in South Mumbai. Trees that have been there for hundreds of years.
This issue is already settled.
Okay.
These people raise this issue maybe out of their inability to see a larger picture.
Okay.
However, they raised it to court. And High Court has properly decided that issue and also deliberated upon how we have to cut a balance between development and environment. And High Court judgment, if you just go through it, it is very well, it has very well spelled out how the tree cutting is to be dealt. And if you see a larger picture, there are about 27 lakh trees in Mumbai.
Yes.
And now we have to, for the alignment, we have to cut around 2800. Out of that also, tree authority asked us to transplant about 1800 trees. So that we have done.
The transplanting is happening.
Yeah, transplantation is done.
Where are these trees transplanted to?
Different location, wherever we got space for that. And in lieu of 1000 trees which are cut, we have planted almost 20,000 trees.
Okay.
So I think, again, we have to see the larger picture, because why this project? This project is needed to take care of the environment in the long run. Because unless you have rail-based public transport system, the vehicles which are using the fossil fuel, they are going to increase. If you see last 5 years, there is an increase of almost 57% in the vehicles, the motor vehicles in the city. So it means today also every day we are cribbing for these traffic jams. Not all of them are on account of the metro works, because almost 1,000 vehicles are even today added to city every day.
Yeah.
So if that is the case, ultimately what are the options before us? So in the long run, as has been done in any other city in the world, like Mumbai or all capital cities of different countries, you will find they have a very robust rail-based public transport system, because that is the only option which probably given to people to have a transport which is green transport.
So, you were in the MMRDA when the monorail project was done. I remember this was about 12, 13 years ago. The monorail project also received a lot of criticism for the fact that it's not a viable solution for Mumbai. But the government went ahead and built it anyway. We're now seeing that there are no takers for the current stretch of the monorail that is active. It constantly has problems. It constantly has bugs. It's constantly stopping and starting again. It is a lot of public money that has been used, but it's not very useful. What went wrong with the monorail?
I am not the right person to talk about it, but what I understand is because that entire corridor is still not commissioned. So any utility of public transport would depend on how much spread it has and how much catchment area it takes care of. So in monorail, the first 8 kilometers was commissioned in 2014, some 4 years back. And the remaining was to be commissioned in an year's time. But for various reasons, which MMRDA may be able to throw light on, this further 11 or 12 kilometer corridor is not yet commissioned. And that is why we feel that there is less ridership on that first stretch. But if you connect the entire corridor, that corridor is passing through some such congested areas where there is absolutely no other public transport connectivity. So the first and foremost thing is that needs to be entirely commissioned. Before that, any inference about the utility of that project would be premature. But I also agree that the further corridor, the second phase, needs to be commissioned ASAP. Secondly, public transport, again, as a network, unless it is fully developed as a network and all the corners of the city are properly connected, its utility is, cannot be fully exploited. For example, in Delhi, now they have almost 300 kilometers of network. So then you can, you know, reach to different cities, and utility for people is more. So people use it. Otherwise, people would like to have some other mode of transport which will take you to end-to-end connectivity. So that, I think, needs to be seen. Now, if you see this government, what they have done, they have started all metro corridors, the construction simultaneously. So almost 200 to 300 kilometers of metro network would be ready in next 4 to 5 years, which will give tremendous utility as far as common commuters are concerned, because then the metro will be at a very reachable distance from their respective location. And these are the phases during construction. And all the cities across the globe have gone through these phases. Unless the entire network is commissioned, people won't see the utility. But you have to start somewhere, because these are huge capital intensive projects and you can see the complexity of operations. So somewhere you have to start. Maybe initial phase people may think that it is not fully utilized. But in the long run, because we are talking of almost 100 years, 100, 150 years, that is the life of these projects. So if you take that huge long lifespan, then this phase will pass in another 3 to 4 years, and it will be at public service.
We understand that the Chief Minister is particularly bullish about this project before the next election, and he wants to be able to inaugurate at least some portion of it before 2019 or mid-2019. Will there be any portion of the metro ready?
No, I don't think that government has this in mind, that it is to be inaugurated for the elections. At least we have not such instructions. But government is definitely pushing this project because the city needs it. And this is a fully underground corridor, so it is very difficult to commission part of it. We will be doing it in two phases, but that phase also has to be of a particular length. You can't just, from one station to another, you can't commission that corridor. Plus, metro is a very comprehensive system. It is not only the tunnel. Yes. Once the tunnel is done, we have to lay the rail tracks. Then we have to put tunnel ventilation system, station ventilation system, signaling and telecommunication system. So they can't be done in bits and pieces. It has to be a comprehensive system which needs to be put in place.
What sort of safety gets put into place for a train that moves underground like this? Mm-hmm. Obviously, we'll get to leapfrog the other cities and go to the latest in terms of safety and in terms of science and technology. What are we using here in Mumbai?
See, we have the most important feature of the safety systems here is the signaling. Because signaling has to be of the latest technology. So we are going for this communication-based signaling system, CBTC, that is called. So that is the latest. And which also enables us to go for driverless technology.
Okay.
So the highest grade of automation. So these trains are actually controlled by the control room, the operation control center in depot, or some part of it is also in stations. So technically, they are not driven by the drivers. They are all automatic systems. So we have automatic train protection, automatic train control. So there is no issue of any derailment, or if there is any issue, the train stops on its own, because the systems are placed in such a way that they are not dependent on human being or human error. So all those issues which you see in the conventional public transport, they are taken care of. In addition to that, so many other features, like we have platform screen doors at each station, which we see in some of the developed countries also. So the train door will open along with the platform screen door. So people won't get to see the tracks and this jumping on the track or falling down or trespassing. Those issues.
So basically, this is like they have in Paris, where basically you have a glass door, and it only opens for you to access the door of the train. So you can't fall over. There's no possibility of anybody accessing the
track. All escalators, lifts, 24/7 surveillance system. So all safety and security measures, and even in safety of the train operations, that is being taken care of by the systems which are being placed, and having that kind of civil work as well.
Well, I must ask you, now that we've talked about the actual civil work that's happening, I'm sure when you started your career, it was not easy as a woman in this sort of a business. How did you tackle what people were saying at that point, saying that, you know, on a construction site, especially a government construction site, people who are obviously not used to taking orders from a woman, how do you deal with that?
I have been in urban infrastructure for past 10 years now.
Yes.
Because I started working in this sector way back in 2008 when I came to MMRD as Joint Metropolitan Commissioner. And that time there were many projects which had just begun, but they couldn't take off because of various problems. So I started working with the team, and the team was also stuck because there were too many problems at the ground, because of which they were not able to take it forward. And we started working as a team. I also learned a bit of civil engineering, which is required to understand the problem.
What's
not that I can do on my own anything, but to understand the problem. And then we sat together and went on resolving problem, because there was no space for these projects to happen. So we created those space. Somewhere because the space was not available, we had to make some changes in the design. So I had to talk to the engineers and designers. And this is how I kept on learning things. The engineers also probably learned a lot from me in as regards the social aspects of the projects and so many other things. And it was a two-way learning process. And so there was never a relationship of a boss and a subordinate. It was basically a team. And that same team spirit continued even further. And as we went on completing the project, we realized that this collaborative management is actually working. And that's the spirit with which we work in this organization also. So I have a very, very strong and competent technical team who handle the technical part as well as the civil construction is concerned, as well as the system construction is concerned. I also have a very strong planning team. Then I have worked with the rehabilitation and land team also in MMRDA. So many of those people are today also working with me. And on all those projects, Eastern Freeway, be it elevated road to airport, be it Milan Arobi, so many projects we did together that time. So all those learnings are now coming handy. And that's why I thought gender was never an issue here. And in fact, it was the other way around. If I was more inquisitive, I got more information.
Yes.
So it was like that. So how much interest you take, people are ready to share their knowledge.
I'll be honest with you. The citizens of Mumbai right now are very disheartened with those managing the urban infrastructure, because there is a feeling of the lack of accountability when it comes to roads, it comes to traffic. We have two car subway, Milan subway, both fill up with water every time it rains a little bit. Our local trains are horribly unsafe. It just feels like our lives are dispensable. Like nobody counts us as real people, and it's okay if one or two of us die every day. Why is there a mismatch in what people want or hope for and what the government is able to give us, either through the bureaucrats and through the IAS officers or through the politicians? It just feels like there is a disconnect.
I think at some point of time, problems of Mumbai are overwhelming. And probably the way we approach these problems is also at times, it is like just a disaster control mode we work in. And when we have to see the larger picture, that time probably we get bogged down by the legacy issues, because there are already too many agencies who are working, and sometimes we also fail in looking at the larger picture. And certain things we need to do quickly despite all odds. So I know that even doing this project, people keep criticizing, but I know that this needs to be done, because if we don't do it today, there is going to be a problem in future. So I think that kind of determination, that kind of commitment has to be there. And another thing which I also agree with you is missing is probably a cohesiveness in terms of decision making. Maybe all agencies must sit together and see where exactly the problem is. Because local trains today is not in good shape for the reason that there is no alternative for them. Not single day they can, or even for an hour they can stop
the traffic. Yeah.
So you can't expect of any agency to revamp that whole system without stopping it. So I think first and foremost, we need to create an option for them, which has to be a robust option, like a self-sustainable kind of metro system. Once that starts, some load of that system would go
away.
And then that system should also
Like, for example, the Eastern Freeway, which is from an engineering and a civil works point of view, it is beautiful. It's a beautiful piece of road. But the criticism that it received is that by the time it got ready, the CBD had moved from Nari Mumbai to Nariman Point to BKC and Lower Burel. So very few people are actually using that road in terms of what it should be, the kind of traffic it should be carrying. So is that a possibility as well, that delays basically take away the efficiency of a particular project?
They do take away, and that is why once we plan a project, then it should be done in time. So the delay should not be from both sides. Like, government should also be determined, it should make that kind of financing available or arrange for the financing. The agency should be in place to implement that project. At the same time, people should also see a larger picture. Because if there are some hindrances every time, then project is not completed in time.
So the financing for this project, for the Mumbai Metro project, apparently the fact that you have overshot your time has also caused an overshoot of budgets at this point. What is the project costing us?
So project cost, we have not yet overshot the time. There is, because our project has an inbuilt time frame of six years, and okay, we are yet to cross that. So the project started only in 2016. So we have time till 2022, although we intend to complete it by 2021. But one way it is true, because the DPR was prepared way back in 2011, and we could start the actual work in 2016. But this project is financially very well structured. It is being funded by Japanese International Cooperation Agency as a soft loan. The financing pattern which was used for Delhi Metro and Bangalore Metro, so which is a robust pattern. And this project has huge ridership. Almost once the project gets commissioned, 14 to 15 lakh people per day would use it. So the project is sustainable on the fare box collection as far as operation and maintenance is concerned. For investment, you can't have return on investment in a public transport project. That is why both the governments are putting in equity. So as far as financing of this project is concerned, it is very well structured. But we have been working on this project from 2011. So it took a lot of time to bring the project from the drawing board to actual ground. And it takes that kind of time. These projects, especially in a city like Mumbai, we can't do overnight. But as you, the Eastern Freeway example which you gave, yes, there, because that project was reflected in 60s development plan and it could come into being, but that doesn't mean that the project is not required. Because the city also keeps on changing its, the importance of different places, the demographic structure also keeps changing. As Metro Line 3 goes in South Mumbai, South Mumbai is going to revive again.
Yes.
And because you can't have, the city is already a linear city. So you can't have that today South Mumbai is fully functional, after some time only the suburbs get functional. All parts of city needs to get the appropriate connectivity so that the distribution is proper and all the city is of great use to its citizens.
Ashwini Bhide, thank you so much for giving us time. It's been brilliant. I wish you very, very good luck.
And
15 lakh people taking this metro.
Yeah.
I hope to see it someday very soon. Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you so much.